Hi, welcome back to Understanding Gradle. Today I'm going to talk about registering and configuring actionable tasks. Actionable tasks are the things that do the actual work in Gradle. Examples of such tasks in Gradle Core are the compile Java task that compiles Java source code, or the jar and zip tasks that zip up files into archives. Such actionable tasks have input and outputs. Inputs are files, collection of files, folders, and or configuration data. Outputs are one or multiple files or folders. The input of the Java compile task, for example, are the Java source files and the configuration in the build script, like the Java version. The implementation of the task then calls the Java compiler and as an output produces class files. The jar task takes these class files as input and produces a jar archive using standard Java functionality to implement this. Input and outputs are important for two reasons. First, they let Gradle know the dependencies between the task. So if Gradle knows that the output of the compile Java task is the input of the jar task, it knows that it has to run the compile Java task first. The second reason is the incremental building. If Gradle knows that inputs and outputs of the task have not changed, it can use the result from the previous build run or from the build cache, avoiding to run the task action at all. If you apply a plugin like the Java library plugin, Gradle will already register a couple of tasks and configure them with defaults. To better understand what's going on there, we will now register and configure a task ourselves. Let's get back at our example and specifically at the convention plugin we defined for our application project. Previously, we applied the application plugin, which already registers and configures tasks to package the application. We now want to do this ourselves, so we just use a basic Java plugin. Our packaged application should consist of a start script and the jar file of our application and all the dependencies. The start script is something we write manually and which are added here to the root of the application project. So all we want to do is package the jars and the start script into an archive. For this, we now register a new task. The syntax is the same as we have seen last time when registering lifecycle tasks. So we write tasks.register and give a name to the task, in this case package app. What we do in addition is define an implementation, which is the difference between lifecycle and actionable tasks. Today we just use an existing implementation from Gradle Core, which is the zip task implementation. And because we register a new task here, it's not pre-configured. So we need to configure the inputs and outputs. In the implementation of the task, it is specified which inputs and outputs are required and supported. In the case of zip task, we can use the from notation to add a file to the inputs. So we first add our run script. If the input is a file that I create or edit directly, like this run file or like Java source code, it's usually located somewhere in our project directory. To make sure we use the right location, we can use layout.projectDirectory and then define a relative path to the project directory root. In the case of the zip task, the output has to be defined by at least two properties. The first is the destination directory, which should be a directory inside the build folder, which we can also access through the layout. Then we also need to define a name for the zip file, which we call myapplication.zip. If we run our package app task now, we get an archive that only contains the run script. We can see that Gradle did not execute any other tasks in the project because it didn't need to. The only thing required to build the archive was the run script, which is a file that is already there in our project directory. Now we also would like to add the jar files as additional inputs to the task. For that, we add another from statement. This time, we don't specify a file in the from statement, but the jar task, which means to Gradle use the output of this task as an input here. And since the only output of the jar task is the jar file, we can specify it like we did here. As additional configuration, which is also treated as input to the task, we can tell Gradle to place the jar file in a folder called libs inside the zip file. If we run our task again now, our app jar is added to the zip file. We can also see that Gradle executed a number of tasks it required to build the jar file, which is, in addition to the jar itself, the compilation of the code of the app project, but also the compilation of the code of its dependencies, which are required for compilation. As a last step, we also add the jar files of all the dependencies. We can do that by accessing the runtime class path, which represents the collection of all jars required to run the application. A runtime class path is a so-called configuration or resolvable configuration. We'll talk much more about this in the future. For now, it's important to understand that by this Gradle knows that there are dependencies to other projects or binary libraries which are input of the zip task. So if the zip is to be built, Gradle makes sure that binary dependencies are downloaded and that other projects produce the needed artifact, which are the jar files in this case. So if we run the task again, we can see that also the jar tasks of the other projects have been executed. And if we open our zip file, we can see that it's complete now and we can run our application. You might remember from my last video that I said ideally actionable tasks should be wired to lifecycle tasks, and then the build user should only call the lifecycle tasks. So far, we called our new task directly for demonstration purposes. But of course, we should also wire it into a lifecycle. Here, I'll just add it to the build lifecycle because packaging the application is usually the last thing you do when you run the build. But you could also define your own lifecycle if needed. See the previous video for more details on this. The example we looked at today helps you to understand what Gradle is doing under the hood when you apply the application plugin. And when you apply other plugins, similar things are done just with other tasks and other functionality. However, this is also a practical example. Gradle's application plugin is very generic, so often you want to do something specific to package up your application in the end, and you can do it exactly as we have seen today. This all demonstrated how you register and configure task implementation that you already have available. Next time, we'll look at creating your own task implementation. See you then!